So Karen Hawkins, I'm principal of accessible design at Level Access. And so I have two things on this slide. One is a QR code. And so it's a contact code. So if you wanted to hold up your phone, use your camera app, that's a way to access this QR code, my contact information, like my email and LinkedIn. Or if you wanted to look me up on LinkedIn, I'm the only Karen Hawkins with CPAC, C-P-A-C-C in my name. I am not the Karen Hawkins who is the romance novelist, but I do have my accessibility certification. So those are different ways to find me. The other thing on screen is my profile picture. So maybe a short description for those of you who have never met me before. I'm a middle-aged Caucasian woman with shoulder-length blonde hair. It's dirty blonde. I said at a conference one time in person that my hair was blonde. I got some weird looks. I am blonde. It's dirty blonde. I have green eyes, some freckles. I'm joining you from my house in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Behind me, you can see my spin bike. And my couch, and I have a fancy dancy microphone because this room is super, super small and very, very echoey. So I like to say that I'm a human factors engineer by education. I'm a user experience designer by craft. And now I have the privilege of being an accessible design subject matter expert by profession. But enough about me. I wanted to get right to today's goals, threefold. Firstly, I'm hoping to demystify who is responsible for which accessibility requirements, specifically in a design system. So we're talking about digital design systems. I'm also hoping that you can learn the design system features where designers control the accessibility. However, you get to maintain design freedom and flexibility. And through some examples, I'm also hoping that you learn some accessibility design and documentation responsibilities for some different functions, designers and content creators. And just a note, I'm going to be taking questions at the end of today's presentation. So please throw them into the Q&A. As mentioned, we'll address them at the end. My goal is to present in about 40 minutes. I tend to run long, so about 50 likely. And that would leave us about 10 minutes for questions. That is my goal anyway. So for those three goals, I have two different sections. The first I've titled Accessible Design in Design Systems. And I wanted to start by defining a design system. So a lot of people in the design space, you're aware of the de facto usability gurus, the Nielsen-Norman group. According to them, a design system is a complete set of standards that's intended to manage design at scale using reusable components and patterns. And I love this definition. I think it's wonderfully succinct. And I want to point out three key things. One, that the design system is a complete set of standards. Two, you manage design at scale. And three, you're using reusable components and patterns. So a design system is comprised of three really chunky pieces. We have reusable design elements. We have reusable coded elements. And then they each have documentation. And the power of design systems is that they allow us to create digital solutions that are consistent, and they improve our efficiency. And as a result, they improve our velocity. And all of that results in scale. We're looking for scale, right? Our job as designers is to focus on consistency of designs and to facilitate that efficiency within our processes. That's how we get scale. So that's kind of a bit of a broad concept. And I want to move to the extreme other end and talk about nuance of design. So we're going to talk about the concept of atomic design. It's another concept that a lot of people in the design space have heard about. And specifically, atomic design is a methodology for creating design systems. It gives us a framework to break our interfaces down into these fundamental and reusable, keyword, right? Reusable elements. They're kind of like Lego blocks. And then we have the opportunity to build our interfaces back up into potentially infinite variations. So on screen, I'm showing my depiction of atomic design. I drew this out. It all stems from a gentleman named Brad Frost, and I have a link on this slide to his website. And just a note, I do have a QR code at the end of the presentation for today's slides, so you will have access to all of these links as well. So atomic design, this is the general idea. Atoms, if you remember chemistry, they're like the most fundamental building block. And so if we were to take a couple of atoms and we throw them together, well, you get a molecule. And then if you were to take a couple molecules, you throw them together, you get an organism. You take a bunch of organisms, you throw them together in different configurations. Well, now you're looking at a template. And then if you take your templates and throw in real content, well, that's when we get realized pages. So I'd like to look at an example, the atomic breakdown of a good old button. So our typical understanding, I'm showing two different atoms here. I have a rectangle, that's an atom, and I have a label, it says button. That's also an atom. If I were to throw these two things together, the label and the rectangle, well, we get a molecule. And that is our typical understanding of a button. It's a chunky box that has a label inside of it. Here it says button. But there are subproperties that contribute to the composition of even the smallest atom. So for example, with our button here, well, these properties include things like font type, font size, text color, padding, there's border color, border size, border corners, and border fill. That's just on our two little atoms and our one little molecule. So again, just as in chemistry, we have protons, neutrons, and electrons. They're actually subatomic particles of our atom. Well, in a design system, we also have subatomic particles. These are our design tokens. So design tokens are small, repeatable design decisions, and they store a design system's visual attributes. They just ensure that the same style values are used across all of your design files in your code. So now on screen, I'm showing my same depiction of atomic design, but preceding atoms, I have a couple of little circles for the subatomic particles. So if we go back to our button that we've broken out into two atoms and one molecule, we can apply specific design tokens now instead of just property types. So font type, we have body copy semi-bold. That's actually what we use in our design system at Level Access. Same thing with font size. We use body copy semi-bold. It's just something that we decided to do. We've coupled those two together. Our text color is called interactive. It's like a medium blue. The padding spacing 10. The border color is interactive. Again, that's that medium blue. Border size is called border 2. Border corners are border radius 2. And the button fill is called neutral. So the beauty about this is that these design tokens allow us to be very specific. And as a result, we can be consistent. And as a result, we can be efficient. And where many organizations go astray is that their design systems tend to be incomplete from an accessibility standpoint, of course. So for one thing, they neglect to account for all the different states and all the different variations that are required. So for example, now on screen, we have a text box and it has a label called postal code, right? Because I'm Canadian. And I'm showing this text box in a couple of other states and variations. So I have focus states, I have error states, and you know, I'm showing instructional text, maybe where that would go, that kind of thing. The point I'm trying to get across is that you want to design as many variations and as many states as required by your design system, because then you want to design all permutations of your molecules such that when you get to something larger like your organisms, you don't need to focus on things like, oh, states and variations and interactions, but rather at the organism level, you have an opportunity to think about higher order thinking, things like structuring the information correctly. Maybe there's interdependencies between the components. And so I'm spending so much time on design tokens and atomic structure, because this is where we need to spend more time figuring out the nuances of accessibility in our designs and in our design documentation. And design tokens in particular are where many of these nuanced design decisions take place. So for example, on screen, I have the same molecules as before, a text box with the label that says postal code. I'm calling out just two of the design tokens, even though there are more here. On the box itself, I'm calling out the border color. It's called color text dark, and it's really just like a really dark gray. It's almost black. And the border size is 1, so it's 1 pixel. To indicate a change in state, something that Denis was talking about in the previous talk, we can't just use color alone to indicate meaning, right? So we can change the color, but we need something else. And so what we've decided to do is, yes, we've changed the color from dark gray to like a fuchsia color for our focus state, but we've increased the border size from 1 pixel to 3 pixel. And we've kept that 3 pixel increase in our error state as well. But to indicate error, we've also got some other design decisions here. One is that we've changed the color to an error red. Now, design tokens can fill a lot of the accessibility gap, right? But they can't fill all of the accessibility gaps. Remaining gaps for accessibility come down to other design and documentation aspects that are outside of design tokens. And so for example, on screen, if we go back to my error state, I have an icon of an exclamation point and I have an error message that says postal code is too short. And so this is a structural requirement that is required as per WCAG, that a text element needs to be, an error message needs to be presented in text. And ideally is presented visually in relation to the thing to which it refers. And of course, I'm not going to talk about code, but dev has a responsibility to make sure that that's programmatically associated. That's neither here nor there for this conversation. But it speaks to the fact that there are a lot of accessibility considerations that we can utilize in our design tokens, but again, not all. There are completely lots of other aspects we need to think about. Now, I am going to speak more about design and documentation responsibilities in a couple of slides. We'll spend some quality time there. But before we do, I wanted to talk about the concept of design system inheritance. So one thing we all hate is rework. I grew up on a farm and, you know, I had to fix a lot of stuff because I broke a lot of stuff. And the thing was that if I didn't wash the dish right, well, you know, go back, Karen, and wash it again. So I learned the hard way that rework is hard work. And so it only makes sense from an efficiency standpoint, too, that we start to do things correctly as early as possible. So I worked in the agency world. And if you work at a design agency, you used to new customer after new customer after new customer. That means new project after new project after new project. That means new brand after new brand after new brand. Or maybe you work at a large enterprise and you're responsible for a multitude of digital properties, brands, different components, and that kind of thing. So wouldn't it be great if instead of starting from scratch, every single time, because that's what we did in the agency world, you could create one parent design system. And then each child design system would inherit a subset of features or properties from the parent design system. So like every digital property out there has forms. So we're gonna look at our text box again as an example. Again, our text box has a label that says postal code. And this is slide one of two for this example. What I want to do is I want to just demonstrate how we can play with design tokens. So we're looking at a default state and a focus state of a just this text box from a parent design system. And then I have a couple of child design systems where we're playing with those design tokens. So for instance, the parent design system, our text box is as we had noted before. We have square corners, that's the corner radius zero. We're using a super dark gray that's almost black. It's actually 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, if you wanted to know. And the border thickness is 1 pixel. That's our default state. When we move to the focus state, and maybe if I use my mouse here to orient people for sighted users here, if we move to the focus state, as stated before, we can't use color alone. So we're thickening the border from 1 pixel to 3 pixels. That's all we're doing in this case to indicate a change in state. Now let's look at child number one. Child number one, the default is exactly the same as the parent. And what we're doing for the focus state is we've inherited the design token of changing the thickness of the border from 1 pixel to 3. Cool. But in this child design system, we've just changed the color of the border. So now it's like a fuchsia pinky color. That's one option. In design system child number two, the default state is exactly the same as the parent, except we've changed the border color to a really dark green. So when we go to the focus state for child number two, we've done two things here. We've kept the green. Cool. And then we've thickened the border to 5 pixels. It looks a little extreme, but you know, it's an option. I'm just trying to show you some options here. And we're going to move over to child number three. So in this case, our default state of our text box is that we've done two things. We're saying the default state of the border is now 3 pixels. That's default. And we have a border color that's like a dark purple. When we go to the focus state, well, we've kept the purple, but we've lessened or reduced the border thickness. Now it's only 1 pixel. So now I'm showing slide 2 of 2 for this example. I'm still showing the parent in its default and focus states, but I now have children design system examples up of 4, 5, and 6. So for 4, all we did here for the default state is round the corners from square to rounded a little bit. And then as a result for the focus state, we've kept the rounded corners and we've thickened the border to 3 pixels. We've kept the color all the same. In child 5, the default state of our text box, we're still rounding the corners from the default parent. But when we go to the focus state, we're trying something a little bit different. Not only are we thickening the border, because we can do that, but we've changed the radius to 0, which means we don't have rounded corners for our focus state. They're square now. Cool. And design or system for child number 6, we kept the focus state of our text box exactly the same as the parent. And in this case, we're doing something a little bit different. What we've done is we've thickened just one border and it's on the vertical edge. And so we have quite a large area of the text box that's now this really dark gray, almost black. And so it's not captured in any of the design tokens that we were talking about. It's actually just a little bit different. But I just hope that you can see for each of these child states within these child design systems, I just wanted to show you how you can play with the design tokens. You can still be on brand per child design system. You can clearly convey state changes, even not relying on color. And then we're fully accessible. I hope you can see too that these resulting experiences would be consistent within one design system, but through the inheritance as well. And so smart use of inheritance improves your team efficiency and therefore your team velocity too. So I also want to make a point that there are lots of artifacts, lots of bodies of work that all contribute to our design system ecosystem. And so an example would be a style guide, right? It provides your context, it provides your instructions for all of your components and patterns. And so in a style guide, we track things like, oh, our color hex codes, topography scales, your grids and your do's and don'ts and stuff. So style guides map best to atoms and your subatomic particles. And so this is where you want to spend time on your design tokens. And a component library, well, that's a set of your reusable UI elements. And you know these, they can stand alone, you can form them into larger patterns. So for example, I'm showing an inline link. I've got 3 different buttons, primary, secondary, and tertiary showing. I've got a checkbox group. I have a radio button group. I have a wireframe of a dropdown and a wireframe of a text box. So components map best to your molecules. And this is where you spend time on your foundational aspects. Things like your state design and your component variations, but also keyboard interactions and your screen reader experiences. And then a pattern library would be a collection of your UI patterns. And really that's just groups of components. So for example, on screen, I'm showing a toolbar and it has a search field and it's got a bunch of ZTAs, there's a title and some other text. And really the whole point is to action on a query. I'm showing a navigation menu. It's like a hamburger menu that's exposed. And I'm also showing a slide out. Slide outs are really great for housing things like filters or a mini cart. So patterns map best to organisms. And so this is where you get to spend time on that higher order thinking that I talked about a little while ago. Things like reading order, focus order, landmarks, skip links, and interdependencies between multiple components. What I mean by that, maybe a good example is in e-commerce. We have product cards, they have an add to cart button. If I click on add to cart, well, there's a relationship between that product card and add to cart button and the mini cart that lives up in the header, right? So the mini cart needs to update. We've now added something. How are we going to communicate that information back to everybody? So that's what I mean as an example of interdependencies between components. So that's the end of section 1. The plan there was like to level set on design systems and to show you how we can bring accessibility in to our design systems and where we might want to focus. Section 2 is a little bit different. I want to talk about digital accessible design roles and responsibilities. And I want to look at the functions of the design team, not the roles. You'll see in a sec why I say that, but it's the functions of the people who contribute to the creation and the maintenance of design systems specifically. So on screen, in my opinion, the design team includes a user experience designer or UX designer. Again, that's me. That's how I associate. There's also user interface designer or UI designer and content designer. So for each of these, I wanted to discuss a couple of things. One would be synonyms and responsibilities, and we're going to start with the user experience designer. So there's lots of synonyms for UX. I've been called an information architect before. There's also interaction designer. For much of my career, I was an experience designer, but there's also UX strategist, UX architect, product designer, service designer, and I'm sure there's lots more. A point I want to make, though, is that it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter what your role is, what your job title is. You have very specific responsibilities, like architecture. You're in charge of structure, logic, flow, navigation, wayfinding, interaction, and the resultant behavior. Let's contrast that with the user interface designer, UI. So some synonyms would include art director. That's a pretty popular title these days. But old school would be like visual designer, graphic designer, graphic artist. But there's also like UI artist, interaction designer, product designer, digital designer, and I'm sure there's more. Again, I'll say, doesn't really matter what your role title is. Your responsibilities are different. Brand, styling, the look and the feel, color, topography, images and illustrations, layout and grid, and motion and animation. And then the content designer, I have a bunch of synonyms here, but it boils down to copy, writing, right? So content strategist, copywriter, UX writer, content writer, technical writer. And then there's a bunch of marketing-y ones like marketing technologist, content marketing manager, digital brand manager, digital marketing manager, social media coordinator, community manager. I'm sure there's more. Again, it doesn't really matter. Your responsibilities are about copy and strategy and governance thereof. So content strategy, content auditing, content governance, tone, style, voice. The biggest one is writing the copy and then secondarily editing the copy. Note that I did not discuss a couple of other key teammates, researcher, product manager, developer, and quality assurance. It's because I'm focusing on the makers, the doers in the design team. Now, I also want to discuss our responsibilities. I firmly believe that each of these three functions I've mentioned, we have very clear design responsibilities and we have very clear documentation responsibilities. So we'll go through each of those for those three key functions. Firstly, with the user experience designer, we are responsible for structural elements. A good example is the error message that I was talking about before for that text box. That's a structural piece, that error message that needs to be added to the design of an error state. And that's a UX thing. We also need to make sure that we're providing users a multitude of strategies to navigate. Orientation cues, good old breadcrumbs, right? We need to make sure that our designs are consistent and that they're consistently located too. We're in charge of content flow and hierarchy. By that, I mean, think of reading order and focus order. UX are responsible for error prevention, support, and remediation. That's not just on us, but I'm going to put it on us as the primary. We're also responsible for alternative interactions and experiences. Things like, how does this work with a keyboard? How does this work with a screen reader? And redundant coding. Again, it's been said many times, we can't rely on just color. So we need at least two modalities to express something. And so going back to the example of our text box and we're changing the states to focus and error, well, we thickened the border. That was a structural piece that can be perceived regardless of color. So that's all design for UX. UX for documentation, I'm going to put on you that we need to document the keyboard interactions. And that's a huge gap in our industry. We need to put more effort into documenting our keyboard interactions. But if we do that, well, we should also document our pointer interactions. Pointers include more things than just what many of us are used to, our computer mice. So if we're documenting for keyboard, I think that we should be documenting for pointers as well. We should also document screen reader experiences, not to get into the specifics, and we can't be too prescriptive, and we all know that, but we need to think through and document what screen reader experiences are going to be like. We also need to document roles. By this, I mean, you know, a button is supposed to look like a button, and a button is supposed to function like a button. Same thing with links. However, what's happened over the years is that there's been a blurring of buttons and links, right? And sometimes a link is like this big chunky thing because it takes you somewhere. But in our hero components at the top of the page, we always want to have a primary and secondary CTA, but their CTAs are calls to actions. It doesn't mean that they're a button because they take you somewhere else. In this case, it's a link. So even though it looks like a button, we need to document it's actually a link in this context. And that really needs to be, that flexibility needs to be accounted for, how you build and design your design system. As a result of all these interactions, UX, we need to document behaviors, the resulting behaviors of all of that. We're responsible for error handling. And then there's some rules, you know, around, oh, optional elements like instructional text goes here and character count goes here. And then some, maybe some rules for structural elements too. Now, if we contrast that design and documentation responsibilities for UX to design and documentation responsibilities for UI, they're different. For user interface designers, from a design perspective, everything I had said before, color, typography, spacing, imagery, illustrations, layout, grid, motion, animation. But in addition to that, I'm going to put on the UI designer component variations and component states. So you saw with my design token examples that when we were playing with the design tokens on the states, we were really just playing with border thickness and with color, rounded corners, that kind of thing. That doesn't play into functionality. And effectively, that's what UX is about, is the core functionality of a thing. That played more into the look and the feel of the thing. That's why I'm putting component variations and states on UI as an end product. In my experience, UX, yes, we would design different variations. Of course we would. But UI is always responsible for that end deliverable with pixel perfect variations. So I'm putting it on them. Because I'm also putting on UI, responsiveness. So UI is responsible for making sure that we account for all the viewports, all the different breakpoints, what's the padding therein. Remember, they're responsible for the layout and the grid. So all of that plays together with how your variations are going to be specific. And I think that that's a UI thing. UI is also responsible for the target sizes. Again, because things have to be pixel perfect, they're responsible for the padding between all of the things. That's a UI thing. And then because UI is responsible for how things look, any visual hierarchy or visual relationships, they're responsible for designing. From a documentation standpoint, I would expect UI people to document things like, these are the colors that I'm using. This is the contrast between these colors, and just clearly document that somewhere. So ideally, you would have rules for things like that. You would have rules around your spacing, rules. It's hard for me to say, speech impediment, rules for your images and illustrations, motion and animation rules, and how elements respond. That speaks again to the responsiveness, how things will change at different breakpoints and viewports. And of course, document those breakpoints and viewports too. And lastly, our content designer, design responsibilities. Not really. you get documentation responsibilities only. And I said before, it's really about copy. But in addition to that, you also need to document things like content hierarchy. It would be great if we had standardized or templatized messages, your alert messages, that kind of thing. Someone on the team, and I'm going to put it on the content designer, the author, someone on the team is responsible for documenting the digital properties human language. Let's say it's in English. Great. Well, that's good enough. we don't want to leave anything for to be in question for our downstream teammates, dev. So everything, all these decisions need to be clearly made and need to be clearly documented. It might sound trivial, but it's not. I'm also putting on you a digital property glossary and a definition list, that kind of thing, and lots of rules. I would hope that in your design system, we have rules for how we're using and handling abbreviations. That's a AAA success criterion. Same thing with pronunciations. Again, AAA, but why not aim for it, right? Plain language, how are you using plain language? Which grade reading level are you aiming for? Is it grade 8 or you're actually aiming for grade 6? And I put alternative text here as well. not just writing it, but rules for alternative text. Note, I left alternative text last. That was on purpose because I'm trying to demonstrate there's all this other stuff that we need to think about from a content perspective besides just good old alt text. So you heard me say it a few times, but I really think it doesn't matter what your job title is, right? And I also think it doesn't really matter how your team is structured. You could find yourself, as I was in the agency world, where you do have specific team members. There's a set of people for UX, there's a different set of people for UI, and there's a different set of people for content. Or you could find yourself as a one-person shop. The point is that somebody on the team has to follow through on what these accessibility requirements are, because that's what they are. They are requirements, and these requirements need to be met. So the first step is just to understand what are the requirements, and then you need to know how to design for these requirements. And then you also need to know who should be doing the work so that you can assign the task to the appropriate function. So I'd like to look at an example, the good old button. We're going to explore design requirements and documentation requirements for a button. So firstly, to lay the land of buttons, there are a number of different button types. I'm showing a primary button, a secondary button, and a tertiary button. My primary button, and I'm going to describe them because it's important. We're going to talk about different states, et cetera, throughout the next couple of slides. So our primary button is it's a box. It's medium blue, and it has white text that says button. My secondary button is an inverse. So it's a white button. It has a medium blue border, and it has medium blue text that says button. And I have a tertiary or micro action button, whatever you'd like to call it. It's a text only button, and it's indicated that it's a button because it has an icon associated with it. My placeholder icon is a little bug, and both the icon and the text are in a medium blue. So buttons have different versions too. So those were types. Now we're looking at different versions. So we're looking at our primary button, again, which is medium blue white text that says button, and it's a text only button. But we could also have a button that has text and an icon. Or we could have a different version that's an icon-only button. And in addition to that, we also have to think about states. So again, we're only looking at our primary button, and I'm showing it in 5 different states. The default is as described before, medium blue box, white text that says button. For my hover state and my focus state, I've changed the color to a dark blue. But again, we can't rely on color alone. So we have a structural element here, which is a double underline. Great. In addition, for the focus state, WCAG has this requirement that you have to have some kind of focus indicator. It has to meet specific criteria. So I'm using a pink fuchsia colored box, and it surrounds my button. I also have inactive. You know, the colors are all muted, and I also have clicked or pressed. It's taking the default medium blue button white text that says button, and it has a thick border that's dark blue. You could also have other states, of course, right? Selected, dragged, whatever. The point I'm trying to make, and I hope it's being conveyed to you, those of you who are sighted and can perceive these designs, I firmly believe that each and every state needs to be clearly differentiated from all of the other states. What's the point of the state? It's you are here feedback. And that feedback from the system needs to clearly communicate not only you are here, but what state is that element in? You don't want to mess somebody up, right? Even for a second. So we're going to look at just the primary button in its default state. And we're going to look at the accessible design responsibilities. So I'm showing my default primary button, again, medium blue box, white text that says button. And next to it, I have a table. This is a 2-column, 4-row table. The first column is called function. And under that, I have the 3 functions. So user experience designer, user interface designer, and content designer. The second column is called accessible design responsibilities. And so we're going to go through each of the cells here. Basically, we're going to look at the design responsibilities from an accessibility standpoint for all of these functions. So for the user experience designer, well, we basically just need to make sure that there's a visible label there. It's a structural element, right? This thing has to have a visible label. It's a button. Keep in mind, we're only talking about design responsibilities just for this button. Nothing else. No other states, no other types, no other versions, primary button, default state. UI, user interface designer, has a lot more to do. UI is responsible for color. So UI is responsible for contrast. So a lot of people know that, of course, within a button, you know, your text color has to have good contrast with the button color, but there's another check. We also need to make sure that the button color, maybe it's border, but wherever the button is adjacent to another color, like the background color, well, we still need to have good contrast there of 3:1. So that's all on UI. UI also has to design a minimum target size. UI has to design the desktop version and the mobile version. And I think the UI should be pressure testing their designs for a couple of specific use cases. I'm going to go into more detail about these in a couple of slides, but we should pressure test our designs where the text is at 200%. And we should pressure test our designs for different types of letter spacing, word spacing, and line spacing, right? And the whole point is to make sure that we're not causing any readability issues. Then putting that on UI, because UI is responsible for responsiveness, right? And making sure that everything flows nicely. And so both of those two things, 200% text and changing the spacing, well, that pertains to how things reflow within a particular component. So that's a UI thing. Then I have three best practices for UI. WCAG doesn't have a minimum font size, right? But it is a best practice, you know, for your normal paragraph text. The minimum font size is 12-point font, which is 16 CSS pixels. There's also another best practice I'm going to laugh at, that it's about font type. We don't want to cause readability issues. I'm not going to go into detail about font type, but because there's subjectivity there, but just take that one for what it is. And the last best practice that UI is responsible for designing for is, as I said a little bit earlier, a button should look like a button, and a link should look like a link. So that's a lot. We also have content designer, but as previously stated, there aren't a lot of design things for a content designer to do. So maybe that name is a misnomer. It should be author, same difference. But yeah. So I think for both desktop and mobile, we need to design the minimum states of default, hover, focus, and inactive. This is your minimum set of states that you need to design for. And I'm showing for desktop and mobile here, those four states. Of course, you have other options, click, press, visited, whatever, but this is your minimum set from an accessibility standpoint. I think you should also design the same states, default, hover, focus, and inactive, on both desktop and mobile when your button has an icon. And the reason is, if you think back to us playing with the design tokens, I was using color, I was using rounded colors or corners and square corners, and I was using a structural element of an underline. These are not the only things that you can use to indicate a change in state. So bolding is one thing, inverting colors is another thing. And so you want to test your design decisions on not just your text, but how are your icons going to respond for the same changes in states. And also for both desktop and mobile, I think we need to pressure test the designs for, I'm going to say, all permutations of all that variability that we can possibly have. And the whole point is that people can adjust their experiences to suit their needs, and we need to design for that variability. So for instance, on screen, I'm showing desktop and mobile versions of 200% text and 200% text with a chevron, so that's an icon. I'm also showing really long text in our primary button and long text with a chevron. So this 200% text is an accessibility requirement, right? People should be able to increase just the text, and then everything should still be readable. Well, it's our responsibility as designers to make sure that that readability comes through. We need to design for that. And I think too, if you design for super long copy, you're effectively testing the design for how everything wraps, right? It's that responsive piece again. And that's going to cover off that other accessibility requirement about spacing, letters, words, lines, as little paragraphs in larger elements. So if you pressure test your design for using long text, you're kind of covering that off. The whole point is to see how everything is going to respond. So you do all of that for your primary button, okay? But you also need to do the same, maybe a subset of, depending on what you're doing, for your secondary buttons and your tertiary buttons. So on screen here, I'm showing my primary button, secondary button, and tertiary button in default, hover, and focus states. The point here is that the design of the states are consistent across all these different button types. So for my primary, secondary, and tertiary buttons, the default state uses a medium blue, and that's indicated in our design system that it's interactive. On hover and on focus, the colors change to dark blue, and we get a double underline. And then the focus state also inherits that design from the hover state, but we've added another element, that fuchsia box, that focus indicator around it. This consistency is key. It eases a user's learnability, and the consistency eases the learner's memorability. Both of those things coupled increases their efficiency. So as a result, we're talking about improving the usability of the system simply by being consistent. Now, you also want to extend that styling to other elements, because you're trying to ensure that your design decisions, your tokenizations, it's going to work in lots of other contexts. So here I'm showing our standalone link and our inline link in default hover and focus states. So just like the buttons, our default state uses medium blue. It's indicating to the user through that color use that this thing is interactive. On hover and on focus, we're changing the color to a dark blue and they get a double underline. And then again, the focus state gets that fuchsia focus indicator, the box around it as well. I hope you can see the consistency now, not just between button types, but now we're talking about consistency across different types of elements. I have a little sidebar for you. We're just going to take a step aside and talk about something that's really important to me. you may have noticed that my hover states and my focus states are pretty similar. They're almost exactly the same. Except the focus state, it has that focus indicator. Again, it's a WCAG requirement. This is entirely purposeful. I wanted you to know that. Strictly my opinion, just my opinion, but my opinion is that I don't think it should matter what technology I use. The system should respond in a way that is consistent with what my expectations are. So that means I should be able to switch between any type of technology. I can switch from any input device to another input device, and my experience should be consistent. So on screen here, I'm showing a pointer, in this case, it's a mouse, and I have it next to the hover state of my primary button. It's dark blue, white text that says button, double underline. I'm also showing a keyboard next to my focus state of my primary button. It's also dark blue, white text says button, double underline. It just happens to have that pink box around it. Our job as designers is to reduce friction and increase flow. And any time that you cause your user to pause, you decrease their efficiency. So I think that consistent state design is absolutely key to providing reassuring feedback to your user that of all the things, because there's a bajillion things on the website, of all the things, don't worry, I got you. Here's where you are. You are here, and this is you are here feedback. I got your back. So that was design responsibilities. We're now going to talk about documentation responsibilities, again, for our button example. So now I have our primary button, again, medium blue, white text that says button. And we're going to look at the documentation responsibilities. So I have that button displayed next to a table. This table is, again, a two column, four row table. The first column is called function. And under it, we have the three functions, user experience designer, user interface designer, and content designer. And then the second column is titled accessible documentation responsibilities. And so we'll look at the individual responsibilities from a documentation standpoint for each of these functions. Firstly, we have user experience designer. I said before that we need to document what the role is. It's a button, it's a link, whatever. But we also need to document keyboard interactions. We need to document what a screen reader experience is going to be like. And, you know, we can't be too prescriptive. Different screen readers work with different browsers. We can't be like totally explicit, but we need to think through what that's going to be like. And we're actually going to get to that in a sec. Something that a lot of teams told me that they weren't aware of, either from the design side or even the dev side, is that we need to design and document for aborting. a boarding and activation, meaning somebody's about to click on something, they're about to, the focus is somewhere and they're about to press enter. This thing is actionable, but we need to provide them an opportunity to change their mind. So we need to think about how that's going to work with a keyboard, how it's going to work with a pointer device, how that, what that experience is like with a screen reader. That all needs to be documented. That's all on UX. UI, as I mentioned before, I'd really like to see you documenting your colors, like your hex values, and your contrast ratios. Keep in mind, everything that we're talking about right now is just for a primary button in its default state. There'd be a bunch of other stuff for all these other different types of components. For this button, UI should also document the font type, the font size, what are your spacing rules for this thing, what's your character count, how is this button going to grow with text, are you truncating at a certain point, are you wrapping the text at a certain point, and you should document the target size too. And our content designer, I got something for you this time. You need to document the actual copy. What is this label text going to be? So I want to dig into keyboard interactions a little bit more, because I think interactions in particular are something that are really, really important for our designers to think through and to document. So we're going to look at a radio button example first. I'm showing a keyboard flow as well as a pointer flow. So I have a set of radio buttons. The group label is Favorite Teenage Ninja Turtle, and I have four radio buttons: Leonardo, Michelangelo, Donatello, and Raphael, of course. The flow goes like this. We have our radio button group, and I tab into the group. Well, the focus is going to go to the first radio button. If I use an arrow down or to the right, I'm going to go down to the next radio button. If I was to press enter on the second one, well, it changes its state to a selected state. And then if I tab out of the radio button group, I'll actually leave the radio button group. It's different with a pointer, right? Most people are used to hovering on something. It displays its hover state. And then all we have to do is click and we get a selected state. This is not how checkboxes work. So now I'm showing the same options of the four different Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, but they're in checkbox state, meaning multi-select. And I've also changed the design a little bit to include a select all checkbox at the top of the list. That's just a best practice if you have two or more checkboxes. So the keyboard flow for this is going to be different. If I tab into the checkbox group, well, the focus goes onto the first checkbox and I get a focus state. Now what I do is I tab to the next checkbox. I don't use my arrows. I tab to it. If I press enter or spacebar or whatever, then I get the selected state. And if I tab again, I don't tab out of the checkbox group. My next tab takes me to the next checkbox in the sequence. And then the pointer experience is basically the same as the pointer experience for video buttons, hovering and clicking and whatnot. This is something that's really important to know. Know that the basic functionality of these sister components, radio buttons and checkboxes, they look the same. They kind of function basically the same, but the way you use a keyboard is actually really different. You need to know that in order to design for them properly. So for keyboard interactions, you want to think about things like when something's on focus, what are the keyboard interactions, or specifically on input. That's really important from a keyboard standpoint. When people are taking action on things, I'm going to select something, I'm going to expand something. What are the keyboard interactions? And then also navigating within a component, specifically complex components, a product card that has a lot of actionable elements, a modal or an overlay. That's navigating within a component using a keyboard, but then also between components. How do we facilitate that ease of navigation, jumping around the page, basically increasing people's efficiency from going to wherever they want to go to? And I also think it's important to think through and document screen reader experiences. I said before, you can't be too prescriptive. I'll say it again a million times, but screen readers work differently. They all work differently with different browsers. I'm not trying to be that prescriptive, but what I think you might want to do is to work through a flow of a user landing on a particular element. They're going to interact with it. So they're going to give some information. They're going to get back some information. That might happen a couple of times. And then eventually at some point they leave that element. So you need to ask yourself, like, how does this actually work? And what is the screen reader going to say? If I use different keys, what does that all look like? Is it clear at every point in the process what's going on? So on screen here, I'm showing an example of what I'm calling an auditory experience. It's just a wireframe of a text box. It has a placeholder for a field label. There's an asterisk next to it. Of course, if I was designing a real form, I would have somewhere above it what the asterisk means, but that's not part of this component design. There's a placeholder for instructions, a placeholder for character count, and an empty text box. So the flow is like this. If we tab onto the text box and it's empty, the question is, what's the screen reader experience going to be like? Well, it's probably going to announce the field label, whether it's required or not. If the instructions are there, it should include the instructions. If the character count is there, it should include the character count. Because the box is empty, well, it's not going to announce anything that's in the box. Okay, cool. If I start to type, like I type a T, the screen reader is just going to say T. It's not going to say all of that other stuff because it just said all of that stuff. And if you start to type long strings, if you pause, like these are all the different things that you need to think about. The point is, if you don't know how a screen reader works, there are free screen readers. And so Max, which I have, has a free screen reader called VoiceOver. And there's another one, NVDA, that you can download. It's for Windows. Like, just get a screen reader, start using them, because if you don't know how they work, you can't design properly for them. So the things you need to realize about screen readers is that your content is serialized or linearized, meaning you can think of all of the content. I'm going to say web page, for instance. It's just in a big long list. And you're going from one single thing to the next thing in the list. How does that change your experience? And if your experience was serialized or linearized, what would you do to maximize efficiency and to make sure that people really understood where they were and what they were interacting with? For screen readers, you also want to think about element uniqueness. And if you can't get uniqueness, like you've got a whole bunch of edit buttons or links in your checkout process, like edit, 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 edit. Well, can they be differentiated, such as edit first name, edit address? And then that context per element is also really, really important for screen reader users. They just need to be aware of all the right information in order to make an informed decision. So, in summary, for section two about roles and responsibilities, specifically to design systems, I think that designers, we have two accessibility foci. And think of it this way. For every atom, molecule, and organism that you have in your design system, you want to design all permutations as to what the thing looks like. And you want to document all of the expectations about how this thing is going to work and how it behaves. So at this point, I'm going to open it up for questions. But as I do, I want to hold up this slide for a moment. This slide has two QR codes. One of them is the same QR code that I had at the beginning. It's my contact card. And so that has my LinkedIn and my email details. Again, you can find me, Karen Hawkins, on LinkedIn with CPACC. I'm also in Toronto. That's a good way to find me. The other QR code is for today's slides. So I post my slides on a site called Notist, N-O-T-I-S-T. And the URL in particular for it, if you don't have access to QR codes, that doesn't work for you from an accessibility standpoint, I'll read out the URL. So it's the good old https://. And then it's noti.st/khawk27. So I'll keep this slide up as we take questions.
Great. Thank you, Karen. That was wonderful. There are a lot of questions and a lot of conversation in chat. There were three questions that came in that are related. One was, could you give examples or templates of this documentation? Another was, do you have any examples of the keyboard and pointer interaction documentation? And a third related question, do you have an example of good documentation for things like keyboard interactions and other items listed on slide 29? Having a good example would help me in conversations with the accessibility teams at vendors my agency does business with and our own development folks.
Yeah, good questions. Well, I can say that our design system probably has some really good documentation. There are a couple of folks in the accessibility space. Stephanie Walker is one. She talks a lot about accessibility annotations. So your definition of annotations can mean different things. And sometimes when I say documentation, I mean annotations, and sometimes I mean other types of documentation. So that's definitely one thing, is to think about documentation in terms of annotations. Another would be going through like I showed in a flow, like really thinking through that flow. We did that for our design system. We stepped through the designs and the interactions. And so it's like a designed flow. That's really helpful, I think, for a lot of dev and other key stakeholders, like your business analyst or your product manager. And then I'll be honest too, like our stories are really helpful. It should do this, it should do that, that kind of thing. There are some other resources, like I have stuff on Behance. So I've got a good annotation documentation thing there about where I have the design. And then I have annotations on the right-hand side. I will say too that we're putting something up on our site very soon, level access. They're like these accessible principles and heuristics. I know DQ has something similar. And so we've got some really good documentation advice there, and that should be coming in October.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Next question, any recommendations on how to implement design systems in content management systems like WordPress and Drupal?
Well, they are a little bit different, aren't they? Right. So your content management system, I think, is a sister element to the design system. The design system really is meant to be templates, empty Lego blocks that are agnostic of whatever your content is, right? And this way we can reuse these templates, design templates and code templates. It doesn't matter what the content is. And so you get realized pieces when you do throw that real content in. And so that would be my answer to that.
Okay, great. Another question, this really prompted some discussion in chat. And I think the conclusion was that the web content accessibility guidelines don't require this, but it's still good practice. So the question is there a minimum standard for border widths as long as adjacent colors have sufficient contrast?
I'm guessing there was a lot of chatter around that. Yeah. Okay. Just chalk it up to this. You're looking for perceivability and you're looking for differentiation. Right. And so when we're talking about our button borders, is it clear where the button ends? And I'm going to say the background begins. That's what you're looking for. So, you know, you think of in engineering, there's the inverse principle, right? And so if we think of contrast and size as inverses of each other, if you increase the color of something and it has really good contrast against something else, well, then you can reduce the size of it. And the reverse would be true. You would have to increase the size of one thing if the color difference between the two things that you're trying to compare is too similar. So maybe employ that inverse principle to help you out.
Okay, great. Maybe we'll sneak in one more. This is a good one. Could you share what your path was to learning all of these skills that you now have, and maybe share that with others?
That's a really good question. So I started out in the agency world, like I mentioned, and I was a user experience designer, but I was fortunate to be mentored by someone in the dev space. Allison Walden, she's in Toronto. She works at Publicis Sapient. She's like a fantastic accessibility guru. She's been touting digital accessibility for 15, 20 years, a real guru. But she had the foresight a really long time ago, that is, to recognize that not everything is a dev responsibility when it comes to accessibility. And she was seeking like an accessibility partner in the design space because she knew that there were a lot of things that we can handle in design. And so she kind of took me under her wing and showed me the ropes. So I did a number of her devs on her team, and have the utmost respect for the accessibility team at Publicis Sapient. But I also had to take responsibility for myself. The dev perspective in general, I think, is different than the design perspective. And so I took a different perspective at things like, how can I design things to be different and still be beautiful, still be highly functional? And I'd have to talk to dev to make sure that what I was planning was actually going to work, given whatever systems or constraints that they had. So a lot of it was trial and error. I also started teaching. And they do say, and it's very true, that if you want to learn something, you teach it. So I started teaching internally at that time at Publicis Sapient to the other designers. I broke apart individual components and I thought through, how is this actually going to work with keyboard? How is it going to work with a screen reader? Am I ensuring I have all of the states, all of these principles that I was talking to you about today? And I started to speak at conferences. That's actually where I met Rob. That's where I met Jonathan as well. And so, you know, speaking gives you a really good opportunity to network and to meet more people. You'll learn from those people as well. And really, I was climbing the ropes as a UXer. I was a director, and I wasn't doing what I loved. I wanted an opportunity where I could focus just on accessibility. And I was very fortunate that at the time, Essential Accessibility was looking for a trainer. And I'm pretty good at making presentations. I kind of know my accessibility stuff. And they took a chance on me to be their trainer. And over the last couple of years, we merged with Level. So we're now Level Access. And I've transitioned into our subject matter expert. So I think it's a unique story, but I hope that you can take, you know, some of the tenets of my learnings and apply them to your own journey.